Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage your host, Allison Dunn.
All right, good morning. I want everyone up on your feet, please. All right, I'm going to lead you in our action coach tradition of a nice big stretch before we stretch ourselves for learning. So. To your right, your other right. Hands on your hips. And down to the ground. See what you can touch. Oh, that feels so good. All right, take a seat. Good morning, everyone. I'm so excited that everyone is here, and I just want to welcome you and thank you for being here. I am stoked about this day and what we have in store for you. This is our very first Boise Business Excellence Forum, and in doing so, it is part of our vision, which is to bring abundance through Idaho through business reeducation. And so thank you for being excellent. Thank you for committing your time to be here today and investing in this journey. What I would like to do is to quickly thank our amazing sponsors, because without them, this wouldn't be possible. So I would like to give a huge thanks to the team at Adelant. Thank you. At Hiring Steps, Sandler Training, CapEd Credit Union, Matrix, and BNI. And then a huge thank you to the undying effort of my team at Deliberate Directions, all of the folks who helped put this together from Sona Productions, the Boise Center, and then of course Brad Sugars at Action Coach. So I want to give you a brief overview of what we're going to be doing here today. Today is going to be interactive, and you're going to get to meet a whole lot of new people, hopefully throughout the day. At each session, we'll be working kind of at our tables. Sometimes we'll be working with other tables, and I realize that it's an opportunity to not only network and connect, but maybe even get outside our comfort zone a little bit. So I encourage you to do that. We also are going to be at the break at the end of each session. We're going to clear the room. We have refreshments at the end of each session, so we'll encourage everyone to leave the room, and we'll reset the room. So when people come in, just choose a new table and some new faces to meet, okay? So with that, I am very excited to introduce our first speaker for today. And for those of you who are wondering, he is not my father. He is not my uncle, and he's definitely not my brother, and definitely not my husband. So, although we share the same namesake, I hope that in some way we are related and would welcome him to my family if that was actually the case. He comes from Singapore, and he is the chairman of Buy One, Give One, which is an incredible organization that is a unique engine for giving. He is a four-time TEDx speaker who has traveled the world speaking and mentoring. He is the recipient of the Global Lifetime Achievement Award for service to accounting professions, although he's not an accountant, so be prepared that he's not an accountant. He is a senior fellow of the world's leading business think tank and is now a fellow of Singapore's Social Innovation Forum, an honor he shares with Jet Li, which is kind of cool, and the chairman of Walmart, Rob Walden. We are a B1G1 lifetime partner, and I love the fact that we, as a small business, can make dramatic impact in small ways. He's going to be sharing with us the positive difference in our world through the stunning power of small. Please join me in welcoming Paul Dunn.
Come here for a second. Good morning. All righty. Now, you know when you gave the team applause, right? There's levels of applause. What I want you to do, this is awesome, isn't it? Just awesome. So would you give, here's the term, rapturous applause to all the sponsors and in particular to Allison for putting this together. Rapturous! Whoa! There we go. Allison, thank you. And I am actually her brother, she fibbed. No, that's not true. Good morning. I'm not sure where it was you came from, but I'm really delighted that you're here. I had a pretty big journey all the way from Singapore, but it's very humbling to be able to share part of this day with you. It's just a privilege to be with you. It seriously is. Of course, at my age, it's a privilege to be anywhere, but particularly with you today, right? So let me see. I think about this day, and I think if we look up there for a second, I know just as a result of what we've been doing over the last 3 days, around America, that this really is a business-changing day. It really, really is. So let me just check who's who in the room. Can I just see the hands of the business owners? Can I see the business owners? Nice up high now. Good, good, good. Thank you very much. Could I see the hands of those who work for those mad people who own businesses? Can I just see hands? That's didn't get every hand. So let's see again. Business owners, where are you? Team members, where are you? Still didn't get every hand, so that means there must be someone in the room. Let me ask this question. Is there anybody who's a business owner who wishes to heck they were not? Is anybody there? Sometimes it just gets so challenging. Anyway, you are in the right place. That's what I want you to do. By the way, one of the things we need you to do as well as we go through the day so that you get the most out of this is actually to put a fair bit in as well. So here's what I want you to do. Just let's begin by taking a note. You'll get to it later on in the day, but I want you to take a note of this. Just take it down. It's a little place. Don't go there yet. Don't go there yet. Just b1g1.com/connect. There's a big surprise waiting for you in about an hour and a half's time. So just make a note of it so that you know where to go. So it is a business-changing day. And here's one of the reasons. I don't know about you, but as I travel around the world and mentor with literally hundreds, actually thousands now, of business owners around the world, what I come to the conclusion of is this. There's never been a time like this. And I don't mean that in a Buddhist kind of moment-to-moment sense. What I mean is that those of us who started businesses recently, well, actually a long time ago, we never started those businesses experiencing what we're experiencing today. Time, as it turns out, time is really compressed. Things are happening. This is my hallucination slide, by the way. So you're supposed to. Yeah. Time is moving at a pace that we just do not understand. And as a result, it confuses us. It upsets us sometimes because of the speed. Let me just check. How many of us started a business, let's say, 5 years ago? Can I just see hands on that? How many started one in the last 2 years? Can I see that? Okay. We're gonna draw a distinction between that because those of us who started business even 2 years ago could not have imagined what's happening now. Let me give you an illustration of that. Let's have a look at just what's happening as we think about time every second, not every minute, not every hour, but every second. Now, these numbers are pretty accurate. They come from a thing called Internet Live Stats, which you can go and have a look at. But these are the numbers as of today. Every second, 7,684 tweets per second. Most of them, of course, sent by Mr. Trump, depending on what sort of mood he is in when he gets up in the morning, right? So 7,600 tweets. Look at this one. 2,500, a little bit more of that, Skype calls every second. Now, if we don't understand that that's totally disrupted the old-style telecoms businesses, then, you know, we're not in the world right now. Have a look at this one. This is interesting. 61,000. These are all per second, right? 61,000 Google searches per second. Now, that maybe doesn't seem so much because we understand just how big Google is, right? But what's interesting, I find, about Google is if I mentioned that word Google 14 years ago, you would have had no idea what I'm talking about. You're getting the sense of just how fast things are moving. And talking about Google and the pipe, if you will, that's the amount of stuff that's going up and down the internet, or the pipe, if you will, every second. As you look at this, how many go, wow, these are just mind-blowing numbers? Can I see hands if you think they are? They really, really are. Let me show you this one. This is interesting, the number of emails per second, 2.5 million. Now, is there anyone who gets the other half? Because I know I get the first half of that. Anyone else get? Yeah, it's like kind of interesting, isn't it? And how about this one? Let's check this one out because this number really does blow my mind. How many of us have watched a YouTube video in the last, let's say, 2 weeks? Anybody watched one in the last 2 weeks? That's like 100% of us. I'm not going to ask which video it was you watched. But anyway, we all did. Have a look at this. This is per second, 70,000. Views on video per second. Let me ask again. As you look at these numbers, how many of us go, wow, this is mind-blowing. Can I see your hands? And mind-blowing is fine. That's really fine. But what does happen is some people get scared by these kind of numbers, right? They kind of, this is a good illustration of what they look like. Oh, my God! How do I cope with all this kind of stuff? And some people kind of switch off. And you hear them saying, oh, I'm not good with technology now, and all of that sort of stuff. So, and yet, technology is a great enabler. And by the way, we need to understand what technology does. Yes, there's some cool stuff out there, but what it really does, it's not just that it's cool stuff, it enables us to create new business models. That's the crucial thing about technology, as we will see as we go through. So, because some people find it scary, let me get your sense of this. You just don't worry about the things on the top right of the screen, just in the middle of the screen. Just have a look at what you see on the screen, those letters you see on the screen. Turn to the person next to you and tell them what you see. Go, just quickly, 10 seconds, that's all. What do you see? What do you see? What are the words you see? There you go. There's a couple of options here. This is kind of like how we check you out, you know what I'm saying? All righty, so let's see, because there's a couple of options here, right? By the way, the default option, let me show you the default option. The default option is this one here, opportunity. That's just because it is the default option. So can I see your hands? How many of us saw that? Go ahead. Let me see. That's cool. It's okay to say you did. Go ahead, right? Because it's the default option. But then you looked at it. Show me your hands again. Show me your hands again. Right. The gentleman right there. Your first name is?
Tom.
Correct. Well done, Tom. So. Tom is one of the people who got this. But then you thought, oh my gosh, that can't be what's supposed to be there, right? Because if it was, I probably wouldn't be here if I thought that opportunity is nowhere. So then you rationalize that, and then you go, oh, I see. Opportunity is now here. How many of us got that one? Let me see that. Okay, so let's check this out, because that means, let me see the hands. How many got opportunity is nowhere? Can I see that one? How many got opportunity is now here? Wow, that's interesting, because what that means is you could be sitting next to someone who's quite weird. You really could, because you see, there is another option, which you probably didn't see, and it's this one, opportunity, I snow here. Anybody get that one? It's, oh, there you go, weird, right over there. So, someone here as well, good. Thanks, Mark. So, the idea is, of course, then that's because you're here. This is an astonishing, astonishing day. For all sorts of reasons, as you'll see. And this is where we all come from. That opportunity is now here. I like what Peter Diamandis said, that there has never been opportunity like this. He says we are going to create more wealth. Entrepreneurs are going to create more wealth for themselves. And this is the interesting part. And for society, that's really interesting. And you'll see more about that as we go on. In the next 10 years than we did in the last century. That's the speed of change that is going on. So let's have a look at this and see where we go. Here's what I want you to do. Just turn, see those eyes? They're pretty scary. Turn, if you would, to the person next. You just go on, just stare there at them. Go ahead, just stare at them. Go ahead. I noticed you're adding something else in there, which is called smile. So go ahead. Very good. Now, here's what I want you to do, but only do this when I say go, right? When I say go, I want you to do this. I want you to turn to that person, keep turning at him, and I want you to do this, and maybe you want to do it with a big high five, which is kind of cool. You say to them this, as you look at them, you say, opportunity is now here, and I'm thrilled to be sharing it with you. Go! Opportunity is now here, and I'm thrilled to be sharing it with you. Well done. Give yourselves a big round of applause. Well done. Big round of applause. Well done. Okay. So let's see how we hook into this opportunity, because we can't just sort of be, spectators. We've really got to be participants in the process, right? So opportunity is really here, but in order to do that, or to seize it, we've got to do some things differently. Here's why. I don't know whether you know this guy. This is a guy called, as you can see, David Rose. He's the CEO of Gust. He started life as one of the most interesting venture capitalists in Silicon Valley. And just recently, he kind of nailed an interesting thought. He said this. He said, businesses that are, or any company that's designed for success, or that was designed for success in the 20th century, is doomed to failure in the 21st. Now that's kind of a scary thought, and I don't mean to be negative about the thought, but what it means is if we have a model that was successful years ago, the reality is that we probably need to have a serious look at that. Does that make sense? Okay. And that's what we're going to be doing in our time together right now. So, and it begins, grabbing that opportunity begins by making a choice to do this. So let's go through several ideas that help us play a bigger game. And let me say this right up front, that the moment I say bigger game, some people go into, oh, I see, what we've got to do is spend money, we've got to do brand consulting, we've got to do all of that sort of stuff. No, you don't. You're going to see that you play a bigger game by thinking in a different way. It's called the power of small. So let's just have a look at some ideas as to how we might do that. Take a note of this one. When we choose to change the questions that we ask, interesting things happen. Someone once said, and I get that it's true, that the answers are always there. They're always there. All we need to do is ask the right questions to access those answers. So let me give you an example of what we sometimes do. Let's say here we are in November 2017, and we're looking at what we're going to be doing by 2018. And so some of us get into planning meetings and all of that kind of stuff, and we ask questions like, well, how are we going to boost our revenues by 10%? How are we going to boost our customer count by 10%? Whatever it is, we ask those kind of questions. Now, let's say you ask that question. Show me your hands if you get that by asking that question like that, you're never, ever going to get an answer that's greater than 10%. Show me your hands if you get that. It's really intuitive. If you got 8%, you go, wow, we hit it, right? Almost. But the question limits the answer. So one way that's interesting is just to change the question. And instead of asking 10%, why don't we ask 10 times? Now, when we say, how are we going to boost it 10 times? It's not magic. We don't instantly get to that 10 times solution. But the reality is that we more than likely will get to the 2 times, the 3 times. Show me your hands if you get that. It's really, really interesting. And maybe as we head towards that new year, we can just change up the questions. Here's something else. Ask, with whom can I partner or collaborate? It's now never been easier to create. I mean, here we are in this lovely place called Boise, and we have people creating businesses, new startups and all that kind of stuff. How many have started their business in the last 12 months? Can I see your hands? It's never been easier to do that, right? Because what we can do these days, irrespective of what profession or what industry we're in, we can get a relatively inexpensive laptop, we can create our business in our bedroom, and instantly we can be a global business. Does that make sense? We can really be global. And one of the interests, by the way, talking of global, oh no, I'll tell you about that in a second. What's interesting about today, Allison and the team have set it up so that you will be networking during that break by asking different questions and finding people who may actually be sitting at your table right now with whom you can partner and do extraordinary, extraordinary things. I'm going to give you some examples of that in a second. But here's the paradox. The paradox is that to play a bigger game, we really do need to focus on the small. Let me give you an example of that. Here's a coffee shop. It happens to be where I live in Singapore. It's run by an Australian over there. Let me just blow this up so that you can see what we're seeing here. Let me see if I go over here. You can see it's a B1, G1 business right there. When you get that coffee, it says, this is no ordinary coffee. When you drink it, you're saving orangutans in Borneo, and then you see the link underneath that, which takes you back to that site. So it's their site. So it's a great example of giving that connects, but we'll get into more of that later on. So anyway, so I'm talking with this guy who runs it. His name is Ben, and we're thinking about small things that might make a difference. So I ask him this question. I say, Ben, so just in terms of these coffee cups, how many of those do you, or how many coffee cups do you have to order to be ahead of the game? He said, well, Paul, every quarter, we order 110,000 coffee cups, right? So it's fine. So how many of those, or what's the price you pay for those? He said, well, currently we pay 11.5 cents, but we're trying to get that down to 10 cents per cup. So here's where you might need calculators and everything else. So if they're 10 cents per cup, and he's ordering 110,000 per quarter, really quickly, really, really quickly, how much is it costing him per quarter. Go for it. What is it costing? Quick, quick, quick. 10 cents, 110,000 cups. Quick, quick, quick. What's the answer? Quick, quick, quick. Which one? 11,000. And your first name is? Pete. Well done, Pete. Let me give you a gift. Well done. Thank you very much. Here you go. Well done. Big hand for Pete for getting the right answer. There you go, Pete. Awesome. Awesome. Okay. So Pete says 11,000. That's right. 11,000. Okay. So here's what happens when you think about connecting and partnering in a different way through the power of small. What we did is we simply turned that coffee cup around and asked what was on the back of it. And there was nothing on the back of that cup, nothing at all. So then the question was, okay, so who do we know who might want to get in front of 110,000 people a quarter? Do you see where we're going? Now, it happens that Ben, this coffee shop son, is in the financial district right in Singapore. And it happens that a lot of people come into Ben's coffee shop who are from there. And he said, oh, I know some guys. He says, let me just make a call. So he makes a call. The call was just a five-minute call. And within 5 minutes, this is what's now on the back of the coffee cup. Take a look right here, if we can go to the slides up there, guys. So can we take a look? Where are the slides? There they go. So there you go. See? That's, and by the way, they are paying him, that merchant bank, are paying him $78,000, get this, per month. Quickly, anybody want to change their business model and become a coffee shop? Anybody want to do that? Right? But the point is, we would never ask that question, we've never got that unless we'd asked and seen the power of small. Everybody see that? It's very interesting to do that. Here's another interesting thing, which is kind of cool. It is to understand this, and that is the environment, this courtesy of a friend of mine called Dan Priestley. Environment dictates performance. It's very important to understand that. Now, let me give you an example. Okay, what do you think that is? What's that look like? That's a hard question. I'll tell you now what it is. That's actually an accounting firm. And you get that it doesn't look like an accounting firm. There's all this writing on the glasses. In fact, what's interesting is when you go into every room in that place, the walls are all either blackboards or whiteboards. You can just write on the walls. It's interesting. And talking of walls, again, remember, this is an accounting firm. Let me take you a bit deeper. What does that not look like? It does not look like an accounting firm. It doesn't look like dull and boring. How many of us get that if we were in that kind of environment, or indeed this kind of environment, that more than likely we're going to be more innovative and more creative than we normally would be by being in the normal dull and boring accounting environment? How many of us get that? So environment is really, really interesting way of lifting performance. Oh, have a look at this one. This is interesting. What do you think that is? Have a look at that. What do you think it is? What's it going to look like? What do you think? What's it look like? Any ideas? Coffee shop, perhaps? Anything else? Well, let me make it a bit easier for you. Let me just zero in on some things here. Let me just zero in on some pictures, right? So you see some of these pictures here. What do you think it is? It's a vet's. Now, interestingly, when you look at that, what does it not look like, first off? It doesn't look like a vet, right? And what's interesting, by the way, you wouldn't believe what the change in business happened for that. By the way, do you get this? The dogs don't notice that it's different. You know, if you get that, the dogs don't notice. Woo, nearly had an accident there, didn't I? and have a look there. But the dog's owners love going there. Does that make a sense? By the way, interestingly, the vets tell me that the dogs do know. And they say, because the dogs are in this environment, which doesn't look like, shit, I'm about to get an injection sort of environment, the dogs are actually more relaxed. They go, oh, that was nice, that sort of thing, when they get the jab. So again, environment dictates performance. And here's, I think, the most important part, and one of the reasons why I'm so thrilled to be with you. This is interesting. Most of us know that in 2008, there was a massive change. We maybe don't understand the implications of that change, but hopefully through the day, you will get to understand it. Here's the idea. Choose to matter more. Let me introduce someone who you probably subscribe to. If you don't, you should. This is Seth Godin. How many of us subscribe to Seth? Oh, it's cool, right? Well done. Show me your hands again. If you don't, just do it now. Go to sethgodin.com and subscribe. You can unsubscribe in 2 days, but just subscribe. Every morning he gets up in New York at 4:30 and writes the best marketing blog, although you wouldn't think of it as a marketing blog. It's just a fantastic blog. Every day at 4:30, he sends that out. And 4.3 million people hang on his word. And here's the reason why. Take a look at this. Sometimes, by the way, his blogs are really long. Sometimes they're just one sentence. And in that one sentence, you get it. Have a look at this one sentence. The challenge, he says, is not to be successful. The challenge is to matter. Now, that's really, really interesting because typically we talk about, oh, you know, to be successful, I need to chase the money, all of that kind of stuff. But this is saying, no. What you need to do is to matter more. And think about it for a minute. If you matter more to your potential or existing clients, then what actually will happen? You will be what? More? Guys, it's not hard. You will be what? More successful. So the question we need to ask is, how can we matter more? And a way of thinking about that is this. How can we move, for example, from being dispensable to indispensable, as far as our clients are concerned? How can we do that? What are the sorts of things that we need to do to seriously kind of connect into our client base or prospective client base? One of the ways, of course, I'm sure you've figured that out, is to do this. Instead of marketing to the masses, then choose to be irresistible. I love that word. Choose to be irresistible to just a very specific group. The guys down here from Oliver Russell, for example, they're very selective at what they do. They work with organizations that what they call purpose-driven organizations. That's the only people they work with. If you're not a purpose, right? If you're not a purpose-driven, you don't even get a look in, correct? And then by owning that niche, they're now doing stuff with Whole Foods markets and all of those kind of people because they, now, in everywhere else in the world, when I say this word, N-I-C-H-E, I can say it like this, niche. But in America, how do you say it? N-I-C-H-E. How do you say that word? Niche. Not quite sure what it is, but anyway, sounds like itch with an N, right? So anyway, so this is niching, right? Now, many of us have heard that before, but let me just emphasize it a little more. What we need to do is go an inch wide, just very, 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 very narrow, which is very, very scary for some of us who have tried to be building a business by being everything to everyone, which, of course, is silly. You can't do that, right? So you just narrow. And I'm sure you've heard this phrase before. Inch wide, mile deep. And once you own that niche, then what you can do is say, wow, we now own that niche. We've got the credibility. We've got everything else. Let's go develop another one. But you do it by niche after niche after niche after niche. Does that make sense? It's very interesting, very important to get that idea. And I love this. This is from my friend Simon Sinek. How many of us know Simon, as in start with why? We're going to have a look at Simon a little later on. Just recently he said this. I would love that you get this. And this is kind of a little bit deeper than you perhaps thought we would go today. But anyway, great companies don't offer us something to buy. They offer us something to buy into. And that's one of the reasons why Allison is not just a great coach, period. She's one of the best coaches on the planet, because she understands exactly this stuff. By the way, how many of us currently work with Allison? Can I see your hands? Can I see your hand? Wow, that's cool. How many of us don't work yet with Allison? Can I see that? Okay, good. Well, you're going to have the opportunity to check into that later on today, which is great. And also, we know that what we've got to do is build systems, right? We can automate. We can do all sorts of interesting things now. We're going to have a look at that in just a minute. But the idea of this is not to build systems that are just smooth systems for everybody. Smooth systems that, I hate this word, that satisfy your client. Don't you ever say to me that what you're trying to do is satisfy the customer. Say to me you're delighting your customer. Delight is the issue, not set. And so what we need to do is build systems that delight, systems that connect, and systems that inspire. Let me give you a couple of examples of this so that I think, and by the way, in the other areas that we've been on this particular tour, people have really loved where this goes, so hopefully you will as well. Seth Godin, about 2 years ago, said this. He said, we're in the age of connection right now. And once you get that we're in the age of connection, then you understand that you don't have these remote sort of silos in your business. When you write a blog, you understand that the purpose of the blog is not to sell something. The purpose of the blog is to connect. In fact, you get everybody on your team, marketing, whatever they are, admin, all they're doing is trying to connect. Now, by the way, we've updated this a little bit later when you'll see. We call it now, we're in the age of meaning. But let's imagine we want to give this big overall thing about the age of connection. And what I want you to do is to understand the difference between getting that we're in the age of connection and understanding how you work with that. And you work with that by understanding that it's all about moments of connection. Let me give you a little illustration of what I mean by moments of connection. Let's see what I got in my pocket here. Here we go. Somewhere there. Okay, so I'm just going to pick someone at random. Greg, we've not met before, is that right? We haven't met before, have we?
No.
Oh, good. Greg, I just want to give you, let's imagine we were talking together, we've met for the first time, and I want to do something quite ordinary, which is to give you my business card. Is that okay?
Yeah.
You sure? Don't put your hand out yet. So, let me give you my business card. Here we go. Now, I want you to notice exactly what happened when I did that. Yes, coming over there. Here we go. So can I give you my, yes I can, here we go. Oh, did you see? Are you seeing what's happening? It's really interesting. I'm not sure where the camera can pick this up best. Let's go back here. This might be interesting. Could you just turn this way a little second and we might be able to see. Okay, let's have a look at this. So we're having a cup of coffee or something, and I say, maybe at the end of the meeting, something like that. Oh, let me give you my business card. Okay, so watch, here we go. Okay, did you see? What did you notice? You noticed eye contact, but did you notice anything else? Anyone else want a business card quickly, just because you want to act on this? Here we go. Oh, look, you're right there.
I'm not looking at the business card.
No, you're not looking at the business card. That's interesting. And look how many hands you've got out. And then watch what happens. Watch very carefully. Here's my business card. Oh, you didn't do it. You're the only one who didn't do it.
I knew that.
No, you didn't. You're the only one that didn't do it because you were trying to look in my eyes, but which was really nice. But did you notice what everybody else did? Maybe not. Let me just illustrate. What actually happened, by the way, this isn't about, you know, tiny business cards. That's not what it's about. What it's about is thinking about, and I know this sounds like getting too kind of detailed, but it is all about the detail. You remember I said that in 2008, something interesting happened. And what happened in 2008 was we learned that we could not trust the enterprises that we thought we could trust. We understood that we could no longer trust the banks. We understood that we no longer could trust the governments around the world, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And as a result, since 2008, there's this trust void. People are looking for something to belong to, but also people are looking for something that they can trust. Does that make sense? So, when I give the business card, first of all, I do it with two hands. Now, that's not because I live in Singapore and they shoot you if you don't, right? It's because we've thought about how can we do this, right? So I just do this, and what you would notice is when I do that, there's this very subtle bow. Now, we now know that there's things in our brain called mirrored neurons. We now know that. It's a scientific fact. And what we know is that people will kind of mirror what it is that you do. They will. So what happens is when I do this, and as I'm doing it, I'm seriously acknowledging you, what happens is you do that straight back to me. Everybody get it? It's a simple question. Everybody get it? Yes, okay. And what happens is, bang, I do that, you do that, and I know this sounds ridiculous, but it's so, so crucial to get it. And when you think about all the systems that you build, is the level of trust goes instantly much higher. How many are willing to bet that that's true? It is true, yeah? It really is true. By the way, you might say, well, how does that differ from what we traditionally do? Can I grab a business card from anybody down here? I don't mean to insult your business card or you by doing this. Thank you very much. This is Sharon. Hi, Sharon.
Hi.
How are you? Oh, you run this place.
Kinda.
Okay, wow, that's awesome. It's a cool place, isn't it? Really cool place. Okay, now Sharon, please forgive me for what I'm about to do, okay? So here's the traditional way of doing it, right? And it's not just with a business card. It might be with a brochure or something like that, right? So here's what we do when we give something to someone. Watch, here's the action. Here's my business card, right? What's that look like? It looks like I'm throwing it away. it looks like to the brain, the mirrored neurons, oh, you obviously don't value that which you're giving me. Does everybody see that? It's going to be so interesting at the break. I'm just going to go, here's my God. Here's my... and you're going to feel like you're in Japan or something. Now, where'd I put my clicker? My clicker is my lifeline here. Where'd I put that? Anybody see my clicker? Where'd I put that? Top left pocket? Top. This one? The other one. That's, oh, I see, that's your left. Ah! So it was. Well done. Okay, so let's have a look at this. So what we're doing is we're looking at moments, not just connection, but moments. And so, for example, if you were to look at V1G1, this is how we look at moments. And so what we do is we use post-it notes, which is really, really cool, and we think about a process, or process as you might call it, and we just move these things around so that we get processes that delight. Now, let me give you a more general version of this so that you can really understand it. In fact, around the world now, people are saying, wow, this is a great little diagram. So make sure you draw the diagram in. Do make sure. And this diagram, I'm indebted to somebody that you probably know of, if not know. How many of us know of Michael Gerber? Can I see if you know Michael? Michael wrote, in fact, if you go to inc.com right now, and you ask on there, what are the 8 books that every entrepreneur should have? His book that he wrote in 1990 is still on that list. The book is called The E-Myth. And you may remember some of the things about work on, not in, and all of that kind of stuff that's in there. Anyway, in 1990, I brought Michael to where I then was in Australia. And I remember we sat down in Sydney that day, just before the program, and he said, Paul, there's a couple of things you need to get. First thing you need to get, he said, is there's no such thing as a company. I said, what? There's no such thing as a company? You're kidding me. He said, no, 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 Paul. All there is just a series of interconnected processes. And so what we need to do, he said, if you understand that, is instead of striving to be a great company, what you strive to do is strive to build great processes and then connect them all together. Does that make sense? So you focus. That's why that fine right there is so, so crucial. So I'm going to give you an example of this in a real-life case in just a moment. But what you do is you take a process. That process might be how we answer the phone. That process might be what happens when someone comes into the store. All of that sort of stuff, whatever it is, how we bill people for things, whatever. You take the process, just that process, very, very fine, and you ask this question. Is this how an inspiring enterprise would do this? Now, there is another version of the question, which is this how the best company in the world would do this? And just about the process, not about how do we become the best company in the world, but how would the best company in the world do that process? And so you get all of your team together and you focus on it and everything else. And the reality is, we know this, the reality is that when you do it, what will happen when you actually do it in practice is you will create what I call a connected moment. And that connected moment is not when the customer goes, oh, wow, that's amazing. No, it's when the customer goes, oh, that's interesting. They don't go over the top. It's just they see these little tiny things. And so you put that one together, you put it back, you've now got color in the process like that, and then you do it again with another process. And you just keep building all of these connected moments. And so that when the customer, after a while, what happens when you've done this, and you've got to do it in detail, what happens is when you've done a few of these things and you put them into practice, what happens is the customer will feel, oh my God, what an inspiring company this is, but they won't know why. Does everybody see where that might be? And what's interesting is, by the way, it's not only customers who know. This is a fantastic way of getting great team members, right? Because the team members that you might want to hire, they go, wow, this is an inspiring company, therefore I want to work with them, and most likely they're inspiring team members as well. Now, let me show you how this works in practice. How many of us, let's see how nice and lovely you are, how many of us have ever sent flowers to someone else? Can I, oh, what a generous lot you are in Boise, Idaho. That's good. Okay, so let's ask this question. Let's go have a look at a florist. So let's look at this guy. Oh, by the way, before we look at this guy, let's look up here. What we're going to look at is the inputs and outputs on these processes. And pause, by the way, doesn't mean what you think it means, which is point of sale. What it means in my terminology is power of small. So it's looking at these tiny, tiny things that actually have huge, huge, huge payoffs in terms of results. So let's do this. So here's the florist. There you go. So imagine you work for this florist. By the way, let me give you the background on this guy. His name is David Costa. There he is. And you might be able to tell from that photograph, well, actually you can't, but I will tell you this, David is not a florist. He runs a florist business. Michael Gerber once said, very intuitively, he said, the worst person to run a hairdressing salon is a hairdresser. Do you see why that is? Because what they will be comfortable doing is cutting hair. So they won't let go. They'll think they're the only ones who can do it correctly. Whereas if you understand that your role is to create a business where other people can do it, does everybody understand that? It's kind of interesting. So he is not a florist, but he's created a great business. And the moment he got what we're sharing now, he went from, well, it wasn't the moment, but over the last 17 months, he's gone. He's in the United Kingdom. He's gone from a business with a revenue of £220,000£220,000 to a business now which has revenue of $1.27 million. And he's done that in 17 months. How many people think that's interesting? And he's done that without really spending any money, just by focusing on the power of small. So let's just have a look at this. So what happens when you normally order flowers? Well, what happens normally is you might get on the phone, you might have seen them on the web, but eventually you'll get on the phone perhaps, and you'll ask some questions like, for example, oh, that one sounds great, and you'll ask, what's the price of the flowers? And by the way, there's other things that these guys do as well, so let me just show you this one. So suppose you're on the phone and you say, in fact, let's do this. Let's just do this real quick. I want you to imagine that you are on the phone. All of us are on the phone right now, and we're discussing the flowers. They've asked us what sort of colors, what's the occasion, all of that kind of stuff. And then they say, well, this one seems about right. And you're at the point where you go, well, that's really cool. And you here are at the point where you're going to ask them, what's the cost of this? Like you can say, how much are these flowers? Is that okay? So in fact, you can say, just how much is it, is what you're going to say. Let's see if we can do this in synchronization. So I'm going to count to three, and you're going to go, oh, how much are the flowers? Just like that, as if, for instance, let's just see if we can get it, like synchronize. Ready? One, two, three. How much are the flowers? That was amazing. How did you do that? Now, what we're going to do is we're going to imagine that the flowers are $107. Is that okay? We're just going to imagine that. So what we're going to say when they say, what are you going to say again? One, two, three. How much are the flowers? No, you're not going to say that because you're over here. Right? You are the salesperson at this point, and what you're going to say is this. Oh, they're $107. That's what you're going to say. Okay. So let me just give you the chance to get it right. Hey, one, two, three. Oh, they're $107. Very good. Notice what you don't say. Oh, they're only, you say they're $107, right? So let's see if we can figure this out. So on the count of three, I'm not going to count you in. You're just going to go when these guys say, interestingly, what's the price? So ready? So one, two, three. How much are the flowers? $107. Very good. Give yourselves a big round of applause. You did that very well. Now, here's the question. The question is, what's going to happen right now? What is the most likely thing that this customer is going to say right now, this potential customer? What's the most likely thing they're going to say? Well, let's make the question easier. What are the options that they might say? Wow, that's amazing. I'll buy them. Another one that, oh, you got to be kidding me. You know what, you got gold on those flowers or something? Right, so they could say those sorts of things. What else could they say? Mark, you got it right. On close to, all of the studies show, it is so close to 70% of the time, in other words, 7 out of 10, if you handle it like that, it's cost, and you say, oh, it's $107, it will be 7 out of 10, they'll say, oh, let me just think about that for a while, and I'll call you back. Show me hands if you can sense that that's what happens, right? Now, do they then hang up the phone and go, oh God, my day has been disrupted. Think, 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 think. That's not what they do. What do? They call another florist. So, guys, could you do this? This is really weird. Just block your ears for a second. You guys over here, just block your ears. Go ahead, block your ears. Go, go, OK? Okay. Now, guys, what we're going to do is when they ask us that question again, you're not listening, are you? You can't hear a thing, can you? No, good. How do you know that? Because you said no. So, here we go, right? So we're going to say, it's $107, and that includes some very special things. Have we got that? It's $107, and that includes some very special things. Okay, here we go. Thank you. You can unblock your ears. Unblock your ears, right? So here we go. How much are the flowers, right? One, two, three.
How much are the flowers?
Oh, it's $107, and that includes a number of very special things. Question. What is, everybody can answer this question. What is these guys going to say right now? What are they going to say? What are the special things? How many get that just by adding those 8 or 9 words on, we've totally changed that transaction? How many see that, right? And it didn't cost you anything to put that on the end of it, right? By the way, I can imagine that those of you who've taken a note of that, you know, it's X dollars and that includes a number of very special things. I can imagine that later today, hopefully this won't happen, maybe in the break, you get a call from someone and they're talking about it and they ask you, so how much is whatever it is you sell? And you say, oh, it's X dollars and that includes a number of very special things. And the person says to you, oh, fantastic. And what are they? And you say, oh, we didn't get to cover that yet. Could you call back? But anyway, I jest. But anyway, these guys, if we go back to that system again, these guys use all of those sorts of interesting things, those little tiny things. So let's get back and have a look at the process up here again. So if it was a normal case, they wouldn't do that, obviously. The normal flower place wouldn't do it. So what happens then is eventually you'll place your order. This is the normal flower thing right now. The flowers get delivered. And if you're lucky, you might get a thank you call from the person to whom you sent the flowers. Okay? That's the normal thing. But at Flowers Unlimited, it's kind of interesting. First of all, they do that kind of thing that we just did. And so their order rate is considerable. They then send an email confirmation, which may sound quite ordinary to you, but they do it in an interesting way. They send with that confirmation a picture of the flowers and letting them know who created the arrangement. So the email might look like this. There'll be a picture of the flowers, and then there'll be an email. Hello, Sally, if your name is Sally. Thank you so much for ordering. We thought you'd like to see a photo of the flowers we sent on your behalf to Melissa. And this, by the way, is all automated. We've attached a photo for you. We hope you like it as much as we do. Oh, and Laura was the team member here who created and crafted the arrangement for you. We'll let you know the moment the flowers are delivered to Melissa. Now, it's not a big thing, right? But if this were you and you were the Sally in this situation, how many of us would feel, oh, that's kind of nice? Show me hands if you would. Interesting. And it costs them nothing to do it, really. So let's press on. What happens then is the flowers are delivered. Now, this is the only thing where they spend a little bit of money, actually. I want you to see the delivery vehicle. Here's the delivery vehicle. Look at this delivery vehicle. It's amazing. Now, what's interesting about the delivery vehicle is that right there is not a door. That's not a door open. That's actually painted on the side of the van. Does everybody, how many people think, wow, that's cool? Right? And that's basically the only expense they had in doing this. The other thing they did was they were aware of all of the sorts of things that, you know, those of us in these kind of things we talk about. We talk about Zappos and how Zappos, you all know Zappos, I'm sure, the guys who deliver the shoes. And so this is a direct crib, if you like, from Zappos. And that is, what's the driver called? Well, the driver is called a deliverer of happiness, right? That's what he's called. And in his van, he has a little tablet, a little iPad. And automatically, he just hits a button. He doesn't have to write anything. He just hits a button, and the system delivers a personal email from his van, which goes like this. Hi, Sally. Just to let you know that we've just delivered the flowers to Melissa at 1:35 today. Thank you ever so much for your order. We really appreciate it, and I hope she loves them too. Danny, deliverer of happiness. Hey? Kind of cool. Would you be cool if you got that? It'd be kind of interesting, right? But then sometimes, of course, what happens is Melissa is not at home. So what happens then? So if Melissa is not at home, By the way, Danny's email, as you saw, lets the customer know precisely when the flowers were delivered. But if they're not at home, then he finds a neighbor, and the neighbor gets a good neighbor award, little thing. They get a B1G1 gratitude certificate, which I'll show you in a minute, or a version of it, and they get some lovely chocolates and everything else. So if you were the neighbor, how would you feel? Guys, it's not a hard question. If you were the neighbor, how would you feel? Like, pretty cool. And where would you order some flowers next time? Right here, right? And you get, particularly when you see the gratitude certificate. 2 days later, the person who received the flowers, that is to say Melissa, she gets, because we know that people who receive flowers don't know how to look after them. So they get some flower food with instructions. By the way, notice this, not on the day that the flowers are delivered, not with the flowers. Why do they not do it with the flowers? Because they want to create another moment of connection. Do you see that? They separate those two things out. So, flower food with the instructions, a card explaining the water change, a follow-up thank you and a little code, and a polite request for a review. So you should see their ratings on Google. It's just amazing what those ratings are. And then, 2 days later, the client, that means you in this case, Sally, you get a gratitude certificate bearing the B1G1 logo. So, like this. So, hi Sally, let me just blow this up a bit. Hi Sally, we want to just say thank you for using us to deliver that beautiful gift of flowers to Melissa. And to make that thank you really matter, we thought you'd like to know that we've given 137 children access to pure life-saving water on your behalf. And that's been made possible by our membership of B1G1. It means I love this line. It means that your gift to Melissa goes on giving multiple times, whoa, and saves lives as well. Thank you so much for being a client. We're privileged to serve you. Imagine if you got that. How many of us feel just awesome if we got that? Can I see your hands? How many? It's cool, isn't it? Yeah, go ahead. It's really cool, right? And what might we do? We might talk to someone over coffee that's saying, hey, listen, I got some flowers. For I sent some flowers from, and you wouldn't believe what happened as a result of that. Do you see? It's what Buckminster Fuller would call a processional effect. Something else happens. It's like a ripple. The stone falls in the water, and then the ripples just spread. It's a processional right-angle effect that goes on. And you and I, we're going to learn how to do this in just a second. So let's get a look at David and just see what's happened. As a result of this, I hope you get that David is seriously connected. David's goals in his business now are not how much revenue can we make. It's actually how many lives can we save. Seriously. Now, you don't have to do that, but I'm just saying that's what. And so it's connected. He's connected. He's got a real sense now of who he is, and he's got a sense of being connected to his team, who are also involved in this. He's got a sense of purpose as well. We'll talk about that in a minute. He's connected to his prospects because they're hearing all about it. He's certainly connected to his customers. He's connected to our world, okay? And he's a business on purpose. He's a business that really matters. How many of us get that from that simple, simple example, right? And what we can do is once we focus on this and understand that it's actually about the power of small, it's all about just finding these little things that make a difference, then what we will really get, and this is the most important thing for us to get, I think, and both Travis and Richard, who, by the way, make sure you're going to love Richard after this, they get this, and Allison gets this, right? That businesses change lives. And the moment you get that, things happen differently in your business. Yes, the business changes your life. Yes, the business changes the lives of your team members. But what if you really thought that the business changes your community as well? What if you really thought and really understood that your business changes our world as well? And that's where we're going to go. And one of the reasons, in other words, let me put that another way, your business right now really can create more positive impact in our world than you ever thought possible. But in order to do that, we need to meet this guy. This is a guy called Michael Jr. Anybody know who Michael Jr. is? You may have seen him in concert. Okay, let me explain what Michael Jr. does. So here he is in front of 5,500 people. And he begins this little chat by saying, let me explain what I do. And he is a comedian. And he says, and I travel the U.S. every night. And he says, I do these 90-minute shows. And every show is different, but there's one thing in the show that's always the same. And that is that at the 45-minute point in the show, I would just pick someone from the audience. And he says, whenever I do that, funny always happens. He said, but sometimes other things happen as well. This is one of those other times. Now, so that you get the most from this, let me just ask you a question. How many of us know that, I'm not sure whether I should say song or hymn, but let's say song for the moment, Amazing Grace. How many of us know Amazing Grace, okay? Get ready, you're going to see Amazing Grace in a slightly different way right now. So have a listen to this. I think you'll really, really enjoy it.
Or I'll meet somebody who's really interesting. So I met this one guy, and he said that he teaches music at a school. I was like, all right, you teach music, you know, can you sing? And then I'm just going to show you the clip. Check it. So you're a musical director.
Cool. Yes, sir.
All right, so let me get a couple bars of like Amazing Grace. Can you do the first part of that? Go ahead.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
All right.
There you go.
Now, what you give me the version is if your uncle just got out of jail, you got shot in the back when you was a kid. I'm just saying, let me see the hood version real quick.
The hood version.
You know what I'm talking about. Just see if that exists. Let me see what you got.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Here's the thing. The first time I asked him to sing, he knew what he was doing. The second time I asked him to sing, he knew why he was doing it. When you know your why, your what has more impact because you're walking in or towards your purpose.
How many of us, thank you, by the way, for watching that. How many of us, I mean, I've been searching for years to try and find a way of explaining the difference between knowing why you do it and knowing what you do. But just quickly, how many of us are really glad that we came to the Boise Center this morning and watched that 3-minute video? Can I see your hands? Awesome. Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well done. And what's interesting is this, is what questions does that bring up for us? And the question I think it brings up is this. So we're obviously very competent at what we do. Otherwise, you would not be here. That's clear. That is to say, we know what we do. So in the mornings, are we walking into our business knowing what we do, in other words, singing that first version of Amazing Grace, metaphorically, or are we walking in knowing why we do it and with that bigger sense of purpose? So let's see how we might be able to do that. If we flip back up here again, so let me just review some of the things he said and then go a little bit deeper. So when you know your why, your what has more impact. Oh my gosh, I cannot say that strongly enough. When you know your why, your what has more impact. And when you know how to clearly articulate it. In other words, when someone says to you, what do? When you nail that why, and you can do it without, oh, it's kind of like this, right? But when you have what Peter Diamandis describes as this massive transformational purpose, it's amazing how you can connect with people, the right people, by the way. So when you need how to clearly articulate your why, what you do and how you do it, become profoundly, profoundly, order of magnitude, more compelling and more attractive. And let's do this. How many of us have competitors? Can I see hands? What a stupid question that is. I might as well have said, could I see who's breathing? Right? And it'd be the same answer, right? So the question is, how do we differentiate ourselves? Well, if you go to marketing school, they say, well, you got to know the features and the benefits, and you got to know that sort of stuff. Pre-2008. But once you're part of this, you really would understand this, and that is differentiation comes from clarity of why. That is so, so critical to get that. In other words, if you haven't got that, you're like everybody else, right? Now, it's not to do with USPs and all of those sorts of things, right? It's just to do with why. And if you really want to underscore that, you would underscore it like this. Differentiation comes from clarity of why, not from excess of what. Sometimes when our businesses go in a hole, which can happen, we've got to add more things. No. What you do is get simpler and get clearer on your why. And of course, like perhaps many of us in the room today, when I think of why, I think of my friend Simon, as in Simon Sinek. Now, how many of us know of Simon? At least know. Show me hands. You all know of Simon, right? And so let me just clarify what you know. This is an interview, and I'll give you the links to this interview later on. There's me and Simon hanging out. But just before we have a look at that interview, let's just review who's Simon. So that's the book that he wrote in 2009 when, as he describes it, his life was in the toilet. That's how he describes it. Now, by the way, I know that what happens at a seminar like this, what happens is the moment you see a book, you write a note. Oh, go and buy the book. Listen carefully. Do not buy the book. Now, you might say, whoa, what's Simon feel about you saying that? Simon is okay about that. He wants me to say, buy my latest book. Not that one, right? But the real reason that I say to you, don't buy the book, is because there's a much better way of getting the book. And the much better way is to go to TED.com and look at Simon's TED Talk. How many of us have seen Simon's TED Talk? 18 minutes of 1 second of pure genius. Would you agree with that? I mean, pure, 18 minutes and 1 second. How does he tell those three stories that he tells? How does he keep going back to this mantra? It's an amazing thing. So tonight, when you go home, make a time with yourself. By the way, here's the quick link. You can get it. Here you go. Just take a note of the quick link to get there. It avoids you searching. It's bit.ly/Simon, all lowercase, by the way. Simon at, the at symbol, TED, TED. Simon at TED. That will take you straight to that TEDx talk, which has now been viewed by 32 million people. So let's just revisit the talk for a minute and see some of the things that Simon says as his mantra. He frequently comes back to this. People don't buy what you do, they buy why you do what you do. Now, I know the first time you see that, you go, no, it's the what, it's all about the what. But it's not. Now, I don't expect you to jump up and say, I get it, Paul, I get it. But let's just play this game. Imagine that were true. And by the way, it is. Just imagine it were true. Then if I go to your website, now this is interesting, if that's true, which it is, and I go to your website, what should I see? If that's true, what should I see? I should see your why. But what do I see? What? Does that make sense to you? When your salespeople are visiting with prospects, is this what they say? Oh, well, let me tell you what we do. Or do they say, can I just ask you an interesting question? Yes. Can I just explain why we do what we do? Yes, you can. And then they nail that why, and then they say, how does that feel to the other person? And that person could say one of two things. Oh, it's kind of okay. In which case you would say, let's say you were selling office furniture. Let me introduce you to another office furniture supplier who really believes what we believe. Now, by the way, you don't do it that aggressively, okay? But that's interesting, right? Really, it's fascinating how this changes. In fact, that leads us to this second point. People don't buy what you do, they buy why. They buy what you believe in. So again, if that's true, and it is, then what should we be talking about? It's not too hard. We should be talking about what we believe in. So just sometime later, as you're reviewing all of the great things you're going to get from Brad and from Travis and from Richard, just review that question. Just go have a look at your website. Right? By the way, let me give you an extra reason for looking. How many of us have clients or customers that we wish we did not have? My hand is only up to encourage yours, by the way. Right? And the interesting question is, why? Why do we do that? Right. Maybe we need to reset and understand that the goal is not to deal with everyone who might want or need what it is you have. The goal is only to deal with the people who believe what you believe. That's how you create an amazing business in these amazing times, just focusing that way. So let's go a little further with this. Differentiation comes from clarity of why, and this one you will not find in any of Simon's talks. This is a private conversation, if you will. Your why must be front and center. Front and center in everything that you do. And over these last 2 years, I've more than that now, but I've really started to understand, and the people that I mentor around the world, this is the thing that really makes the difference. So let's just go play you a little piece from this interview. And what I want you to do is to notice, particularly tune in right away, because I want you to notice exactly the first words he says. Here we go. Here's Simon.
True purpose is always human.
Get that?
True purpose is the idea of knowing why your business exists in terms beyond your products and services. That the infinite goal that you set is something that will leave this world, this place, the people in it, in better shape than we found them. And even though companies can sell the same product at similar prices, the ones that have a sense of higher cause or belief are the ones that will attract people with shared common values and shared beliefs. And that's, at the end of the day, the company is the modern tribe. Why should I join your tribe? I want to feel that you stand for something. I want to feel that the people in the tribe care about each other. I want to feel that the alphas, that the leaders in that tribe want to devote themselves to the care and the advancement of their tribe, not just how much food they can hunt for on a daily basis.
You get that? How many think, by the way, this might be an interesting interview to watch the whole thing? I mean, we're not going to do that this morning, but, and by the way, I'm going to give you a link to it later on as well, but if you did want to watch the interest, there you go. That's the whole thing right there, but I can give you another link to that later on, but if you want to take it down now, that's where you go to watch it. But for now, what we need to do is just to focus on some of the key things that Simon said. And the first thing that we need to focus on is this. True purpose is always human. Now, that's so important to get that. What that means is if you have a vision, for example, which often gets confused with purpose, if you have a vision that says, we're going to be the best, whatever it is you do, in Boise or in the States or in America or in the world, we're going to be the best X, Y, this, whatever it is, I want you to understand that your desire to be the best has nothing to do with being human. It's all about you at that point. Does everybody understand? Let me show you what I mean by illustrating. Well, actually, I'll show you what I mean a little bit later. So true purpose goes beyond, that's the important thing to get, goes beyond the product and service, way, way, way beyond. And one of the things that I do with the people that I mentor, the first thing we do is we figure this out because this underpins the entire journey. And just to review something we said earlier on, the idea is not to give people something to buy. The idea is to give something to buy into. So just to give you a very simple little example of that, frequently when in groups when we have more time, I would ask people just to do something. I would ask them to get out their phones, and I would ask them to record on their phones this sentence. I would ask them to say, I get up every morning too, and then they would complete the sentence. That's, by the way, one of the ways you get to your why. Not by writing it down, but by actually saying it and iteratively saying it and getting it over and over again. So once you get it, and obviously the people I mentor, they send that to me and we work with it and so on and so forth. So let me give you a very simple example so you'll get the difference between human and not. Frequently, when I work with women, and by the way, I just want to say something that I hope you take the right way. I am in awe of women. Is that okay that I say that, guys? That's not meant to piss you off, guys, right? It is to say I'm in awe of women. And the reason I'm in awe of women is because this is a new time that we are in right now. And women seem to get this stuff intuitively. Whereas, it's not to say we guys can't get it, it's to say we need to work at it. But the women, and you'll see an example of this in just a moment. So anyway, so frequently women say things like, okay, Paul, I get up every morning, they say things like, well, I'm not sure this is about my business, but let me hit it anyway. And they go, well, of course it's about your business, because it's about you. So, and by the way, don't you dare start setting whys by committee. Don't you dare have meetings that, oh, we're going to find our why today. No, you're the business owner. It's your why. Which, by the way, other people buy into, and then they have their own whys nested underneath that, right? So don't you dare start to set these things by committee. Anyway, so women typically say things like this. Well, I get up every morning to be a great example for my children. And that's fantastic. That's really good. But see, it's not human in the sense that we want it to be human. Because if you said that to me, it's kind of like, well, good for you, because at that point, it's really about you. But if you just use two very simple words, and the words are so that, and you put those words on the end of it, that's how you, by the way, turn things into being human. Very simple. It comes out like this. Perhaps. And let me just exaggerate a little bit, perhaps. But I get up every morning to be a great example for my children so that they, in turn, can inspire the children that they spend each and every day with, so that together we can make a difference in this community, and so that together we can make a bigger dent in the universe. Show me your hands if you get the difference between those two things. That's human. When you say that to me, I'm going to say, oh, I want to be a part of that. Does that make sense? Whether I'm an investor, I want to be a part of that. And that's where this stuff must go. So let's work on this. Let's see. Let me give you an example. Here's an accounting firm. They happen to be in Perth in Western Australia. And so let's have a look. This is one of their landing pages. And there are some errors in this page. But let's just assume that this thing is a good headline. Let me show you the error. For some reason, I can't show you the error. Oh, I know, right? Because I'm pushing the wrong button. So if it look here. The question is, where's the apostrophe? Right? Is the apostrophe before the S or after the S? Do you see my point? By the way, there are people who are grammar police who will look at that. And they won't use you because there's a spelling mistake in there. They won't. It's like when I'm on an airline, if they give me an empty coffee cup, you know, before they pour me the coffee, and I look in the coffee cup, and it's like there's a bit of dirt in the coffee cup, I'm going to think, oh my God, when did they clean the engines? You know what I'm saying? It's like that kind of thing. So let's just assume this is a good headline, and that's debatable, but anyway, let's assume it is. And then take a look what happens. They say this, they get into the what and the how, which is so usual to what you and I do. This is just an extreme example of it. This will be through a mixture of cost reduction, tax minimization, blah, 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 blah. Join us and achieve more this financial year. Yeah. But when they get the why, and they get that all purpose is human, they'll change this. We're doing this to make a real impact. An impact on the lives of each and every client and their families. Did you notice what Allison said at the beginning when she was introducing this? She said, our goal is to create an abundance in Boise. Did you hear that? She said that. And as a result of that, abundance in the world. So we're doing this to make a real impact, an impact on the lives of each and every client and their families. And we're certain that impact will flow over to our community and to our world. Come and join us. Now, I know that you may not be in the market for an accounting firm in Perth, but let's just imagine that you were for the moment. How many of us are much more likely to click the button because of what you now see? Show me your hands. Come on. And by the way, I know the answer to that question because we tested this. 352% more clicks. And as a result, more clients coming through that just by getting this idea of getting on track. So let's just review this, and then let's just take you to another interesting dimension as well. So true purpose is always human. Oh, Brent, I so appreciate your 10K. He knows what that means. Differentiation comes from clarity of why, and your why must be front and center. Now, what you could do is you could test me at this point. You say, okay, Paul, so what's yours? Well, let's have a look. I get up every morning to help business owners or to give business owners the power to create more impacts in our world than they, meaning you, ever thought possible, so that together we can create an extraordinary world, one that's full of giving. And of course, that is, as I hope I say here, simply a happier world. And that's why B1G1 does what it does. By the way, take a note of this. When you get, it's so powerful, when your vision becomes clearer than your memory, your future becomes more powerful than your past. How many of us get that? Right? And this whole thing about finding your why is really upping that whole purpose thing. So I said that I'm in awe of women. Here's one of those women. Her name is Bernadette Jiwa. I would love you to get her blog. It's called The Story of Telling. And she's a 5 times best-selling Amazon best-selling author. Her latest book is called Hunch, but that's not the best one she's ever written. This is the best one she's ever written. It's called Meaningful. And I'd love you to get it. Grab it on your Kindle. Seth Godin calls this a generous work of genius. And let me show you why you might want to invest $7 to go and get this book. Just by looking at the foreword, she says this: the best products and services in our world don't simply invite people to say, this is awesome. They remind people of how great they are themselves. How many get the nuance in that? Do you get the nuance? It's so important. And it's this wonderful distinction, as particularly if we're in small to medium scale businesses, it's so easy to fall in love with the product. But the idea is not to fall in love with the product. The idea is to fall in love with the person who might be using it. Does that make sense? And once you come from that direction, you just end up with products and services that people love. And this is just in the foreword, by the way, not the main book, right? Our job, says Bernadette, and she nails it, is not simply to obsess about the features and the benefits of what we're making. Our job, she says, is to wonder and to care about the difference we can make to people, ourselves and others, and of course to our world. How many get that? It's such a subtle thing, right? But it's just an interesting way. That's why, as we head towards 2018, it's so cool that you've chosen to be here with Allison today. So let me give you a shortcut to all of this. The shortcut, if we're all looking for shortcuts, is to matter. That's the shortcut. So when we think about that, our job is to build a business that really matters. That's the simple job. Well, it's not necessarily that simple, or it's surprising how simple it is. And that's one that makes a difference to our clients and to our world. So can I just tell you for a quick moment how B1G1 does that? Would that be okay if I did that? Say yes, because that's what the next slide says I'm doing. So so let's just see how that works. So what B1G1 does, and Allison, thank you for your little mention of it early on. Allison is, we're very happy, a part of B1G1. So B1G1 does that, and it helps you build an extraordinary and connected business that impacts lives every day. I mentioned that 2008 was a very special year. In a bigger sense, 2015 was an even bigger year. Because that was the day that this guy, we all know who this guy is, right? I mean, like in England, they get up and bow, but this is Sir Richard Branson, okay? And on that day, Branson, you'll see more about it later on, Branson was at the United Nations on the 23rd of September 2015. And he pointed out that he doesn't spend much time at the United Nations. He was there in Geneva. And he was launching something that you'll see in just a moment. It's called the Sustainable Development Goals, sometimes called the Global Goals. And there are 17 of these goals, not to be confused with the Millennial Goals. And Branson was there together with Paul Polman from Unilever. And he said, I don't spend any time at the United Nations, so let me just explain why I'm here. He said, today is a really significant day. And if you're a business owner, you're going to love what he says. He says, today is the very first day when the United Nations, the world body, has acknowledged that it's not governments that make a difference to our world. It's actually businesses and entrepreneurs that make the difference. How cool is that? Is that cool or is that cool, right? Really cool. Yeah, it's really, really cool. And he went on to launch these things called the Global Goals, which we'll see in just a minute. How many of us know of the Global Goals, by the way? I find that in North America, not too many people know about them yet, which is really strange. But can I see? Okay, that's normally it's about 5%. Don't worry, you will know about them very, very soon. So at the end of that little chat that he did in Geneva, they really are significant, by the way. Let's you and I, he says, explore this next great frontier, where the boundaries between work, this is what's different about 2008. This was the thing that 2008 caused, if you like. And God knows we need this more than ever now. The difference between work and higher purpose are merging into one. We're doing good and really understanding that we're truly one. Truly understanding that is really good and fantastic for business. So I just backtracked you to 2015, but let me backtrack you to 2007 now. So 2007, I'm in Bali and I'm mentoring at a program for some 400 entrepreneurs. This young lady is one of those entrepreneurs. At the time, she was a Japanese chef. She comes into this mentoring session with me. I'll show you her name. Her name is Masami Sato. She comes into this mentoring session with me, and as a result of this mentoring session, she gets this idea, which at that point in June 2007 was called buy one, give one. And it was, you could see when she got it, and I didn't understand what was going on, but she got it, and she was someplace else for 3 days. She was just out there. And so we got back to Brisbane, and where I lived at that time in Australia, this 2007, and I get a phone call from Masami. Phone call goes like this. She said, hi, Paul, how are you? And you know how it is when they speak like that, you speak like that. So I said, I good, how are you? And she said, cannot sleep 7 days. And I said, why you not sleep 7 days? And she said, because we say buy one, give one. And I can't even remember really very much about that. And I say, oh, yeah. What that? Oh, she said, that very important. I said, really, why? She said, because realize that if can sell my food business, can create world full of giving, and that happier world. And the moment she says that, I go like, oh, that's woo-woo, right? Woo-woo-woo-woo-woo. So I say, oh, well, how'd that work? And she says, oh, very simple. She says, you go electronics store, and you buy plasma TV. And I say, hey, Masami, if I go and to electronics store and buy plasma TV, they not give me another TV, as in, you know, buy one, give one, right? And she says, oh, you not understand. And I say, what is it I not understand? She says, you not understand that when you go buy plasma TV, you do that because you want better vision, okay? So how it be, she said, if when you do that, you buy the plasma TV, someone who cannot see get gift of sight. Ah, I get hairs on my standing up just thinking of what she said. And she heard that sucking air thing, and then she says, or you go buy a cup of coffee and child get access to pure life-saving water. Oh my God. Or someone buy your book and tree get planted. What? And I remember exactly what I said on this Thursday afternoon. That Thursday afternoon, I said, Masami, this is amazing. Can I be your mentor for the rest of your life? And this may surprise you, she said, no. I was not totally thrilled by that answer, I have to say. And she said, just get software that helped me create movie for you. I create movie for you tonight. We meet tomorrow in a place called Coffee Bean. We meet at 10 o'clock, I play you a movie. That okay? I say that okay. So I'm there at 9:30 in this coffee shop. She comes in, I've already had a cup of coffee, she comes in. and at 10 o'clock, and she's got an old Dell computer under her arm, and she says, I said to her, you like some coffee? She says, no, I like Play You Movie, right? And this is the movie that she goes, okay, if I show you, this is just a little two-minute clip of this. So come with me back to 2007 as you and I think about how we create an extraordinary business in these amazing times. Have a look at this. She said, Paul, what I want you to do is just imagine. That's what I want you to do right now. Just imagine.
Buy one, give one. A simple idea, sharing the joy of giving. Every second, every day, in every way.
Thank you so much for watching that. I get goosebumps all over when I see it, because I remember exactly what happened after that. Fortunately, it was a coffee shop, and fortunately, there were serviettes around. And as I was watching that, the tears were streaming down my face. And I remember she saw this, and she looks at me and she says, ask me mentor question again. So I say, can I be your mentor for the rest of your life? And she says, now you can, because you get it. And that set off just an extraordinary, extraordinary thing for me and for a lot of other people now around the world. Because what you just saw sounds like an interesting idea. How many think that's an interesting idea, right? But it's extraordinarily difficult to figure out how to do that. And it took us 3 years to figure out how to do that. But never, you know, today as you listen to Richard and to Travis and to Brad, you're going to get so many ideas, and hopefully from what we've talked about. And you might not fully understand the impact of those ideas, because they might seem very tiny. But never, ever, ever underestimate the power of small ideas to bring huge results. Take a look. In fact, if I go back up here now, here we go. Thanks, guys, for doing that. So let's just have a look at some interesting things. So there's the Sustainable Development Goals, and B1G1 is completely integrated with those development goals, you know, no poverty, all of these things. By the way, again, governments are not required to sign off on this, right? This is just businesses that can do it. You'll see how businesses do this in just a second. And have a look at this. This is as of yesterday, actually, not today, but this is the amount of impacts. Look at that, 122 million impacts. Isn't that cool, right? That have been created by And people like Allison have, you know, played a no small part in all of that. And I happen to think this should, I mean, I'm really thrilled about the 122 million, but I think it should be 1.2 billion. And hopefully some of you might feel that as well. And some of you might want to get involved in this movement that is really, really shifting business around the planet. So that's pretty cool, that thing there. Let me show you how it turns, how B1G1 turns up. It turns up in all sorts of ways. And certainly Ade here knows, the guys from Oliver Russell know, because they're part of it. Allison's part of it. Richard's part of it. Brad is part of it, and so on. So this is in a bowling club, actually. And this is just one of the ways that they embed the giving. And you're going to see some interesting things. So, for example, when you look at that wine bottle, which talks about turning wine into water, you'll notice something interesting. This doesn't say a percentage of our profits goes to something. That's not what it says. Because this is not about that. What it says is this. When you buy this bottle of wine, 37 kids now get access to life-saving water. Do you get the difference between a percentage of our profits? Do you get the difference between this thing? This is only about impacts. This is not about how much you give. It's about creating impacts by the virtue of what you do. It's very simple. And just by doing what you do, you can make this happen. So when you get, for example, the glass and you turn that over, when you buy this glass of wine, obviously less. Now, it's not just about water, by the way, but that's one of the things they choose. Here's an interesting one. This guy is actually in the telecoms business, and the day he joined B1G1, which is only 9 weeks ago, he was going to a trade show. And he decided, what I'm going to do is get something to go with for the trade show. And so he created these coffee cups, these eco-friendly mugs. And then on the side of it, his name of the business is Summit. And when you work with us in Summit, you're making an impact on someone else's life through our work with B1G1. On this side of it, you can't see it, but it says, when we give you this coffee cup, a kid in Cambodia, or a kid I think is in Cambodia, gets a library book. And then I think on the other hand, on the other side, it says something about e-learning. And so, but have a look at this. Do you remember how many emails were sent each second? How many emails? Do you remember? 2.6 million, something like that. You may not also realize that as we're sitting here, 700 million people don't have access to water. So have a look at this. This is an email from an accounting firm, happens to be, and this is very common now in B1G1. So let's just have a look at the signature. Sent from my iPhone and changing lives by providing a day's education for child in need. Just imagine if we could get Google, which we're working on, by the way, to make sure that every email that was sent. Does everybody get it? It's like kind of just tiny little things that cost very little that enable you to make a massive difference. Oh, here's one. I just got this yesterday, actually, a guy who's a pest control guy. And so what you do with your customer to involve them and connect with them, you give them what we call a gratitude certificate. So this guy is, as I said, in the pest control business. And so look at the gratitude certificate. We're partners in B1G1, where we can be a little less ordinary by being able to make a bigger difference in meaningful. So today, to celebrate you using our termite barrier, we've given a goat to a family in need so they can have a sustainable income for life. That is pretty damn cool. Does everybody get it? It's like, by the way, I don't know why, but people are in love with goats. I have no idea why people love goats. But no, honestly, it's just amazing how many goats get done in B1G1, or Gibbon, not done, perhaps. We're really thrilled to be serving you. And this is all about connecting. Now, has anyone ever had, what do you call the security thing that you go through in America? It's called the TSA. Is it called the TSA? Has anyone ever had the TSA open your luggage? And then when you get the other end, there's something missing from your luggage. Has that ever happened to you? Yes. Well, sadly, the TSA have something that I was going to give you. And what I was going to give you was some business cards that had the number 11 on the outside of it. I'm sure they're having good fun with this. I'm not sure why they would want this. And then I was going to ask you to turn it over. So can we just pretend that you've got it and I'm turning it again, you turn it over. And so it says this. Let me just blow it up. It says, thank you so much for being here with me. As an extra way of thanking you, I thought you'd like to know that 11 children, just as a result of you being here, have received access to pure life-giving water. And that happened just because you were here. So just to illustrate that, the lady right here, your first name is? Sarah? Yeah, so Sarah, just to get clear, this is not 11 kids for all of us. This is 11 for you, for the person next to you, for the person next to you, and so on. Does that make sense? So that's a lot of water going to a lot of kids just because you're here. Is that cool or is that cool? Yeah, you. And this is not about. This is, I just show that to illustrate what is possible. How many of us are on LinkedIn? Just quickly. Have a look at this. You need to connect with this guy. His name is Adam, as in A-D-A-M, and his last name is Houlihan. You do need to connect with him. H-O-U-L-A-H-A-N. Adam Houlihan. And when you connect with him, and we connect with thousands of people, don't we, on LinkedIn? But look what happens when you connect with Adam. Thank you for your connection request. When you did that, something great happened. You've helped prevent blindness in 11 kids by providing them with a rich source of vitamin A. Not only have you stopped children become visually challenged, but you've also increased, da-da-da-da-da. You get the idea. When Adam first saw B1G1, by the way, he said, I've been waiting for something like this all my life, is how he said it. And this just allows me to show you one other quick thing. One of the things we do on B1G1, just quickly, is we track every single solitary cent of the giving. And you can put that very easily. It's just copy and paste up onto your website. So let me show you how that might happen. This is actually Adam's map. So the name of his business is Web Traffic That Works. So if I key that in up there, and you'll see what happens. The system will just go to where he is. He happens to be in Australia. And then have a look at this next thing. This is where we see all of the projects that this one-man business, by the way, is giving to. And you see the really important distinctions here. This is not about we proudly support one thing. This is about having the option to deal with different things. And so, show me your hands if you're seeing this. You are seeing, I hope you are. How many think that's pretty interesting? Can I? It is, right? It just connects in a different way. So, you know, we can go on with all of these things, but that's there for you. Look at this one. This is interesting. This is a training company, very quickly. They're called Blue Tribe, as you can see. And when we click that link up there called Impact, so people tend to have now Impact pages, just like Alice on their website. We scroll down, we can see their why. Then we see on the far left-hand side, we see the B1G1 widget, which is tracking in real time their giving. These guys have been in B1G1 about 8 weeks. And you can see, again, how they have that up on their website. But what I really want you to see is this next little thing, which is something we're just working on right now in B1G1. And so when you just scroll down the bottom of this, there you go, look at that. It's just relating it back to all the business development goals in real time. How many people think that's pretty awesome? Yeah, good, okay. It is really, really awesome. So, when you're part of this movement, just quickly, and just before Allison comes up to get us to the break, what it does is transform your business. And there just quickly are 7 ways just to kind of give you a thing on it. You can match your giving to things that your customers love, which is so powerful. You can get access to 600, and actually it's a bit more than that now. And as Eddie knows, and as Allison knows, these are extraordinary projects. The board of B1G1 rejects 6 out of 7 of every project that applies to B1G1. So when you see these projects, they're just extraordinary projects. Look at that. You can give from 1 cent. So there's no reason now why we can't make a difference in our world. And how about this? And you know this is unusual, but the way that B1G1 works, because people pay to be a part of the movement, just $200, but that allows us to do this, to make sure that 100% fully, we even make up the bank charges from the credit cards. 100%. In other words, when you give a goat, it's not a 3-legged goat that goes. You know what I mean? It's a 4-legged goat that goes. It's never about the impact. You saw that. It's never about the chief executive standing up and saying, look at this, you just gave, you know, $1,000. It's never about that. It's always about the impact that you create. And as you saw, we track every, it's quite difficult to do it, but we track it in real time. And interestingly, you're in total control of that. Let me just ask you a quick question, then we'll be over this. How many people reckon, that, see all this, and they go, wow, this would be lovely to be a part of? Can I just see your hands if you, okay, just for you guys who think that, which is really lovely. But for all of us, I'm going to show you how you do that in just a second. What I would love you to get is that now this can underpin your business, and you can actually create more impacts in our world than you ever thought possible. And you can get your team involved with that. You'll see some of that later. It's really, really fascinating. So your company transforms. And, oh, what does that say? I have no idea what that says. Oh, okay. Oh, I see what it says, yes. And no, I see what it says in just a minute. And there are those of you who would love to check this out. There are two simple ways you can do this. So let me just illustrate the ways. You can choose to be a part of B1G1 like Allison for 10 years, and you can get me mentoring you one-to-one for that 10 years, by the way, and that is one-to-one, and that's completely complimentary, which is crazy, but it is, and you just invest $390 a month for 6 months, and you're in B1G1 for 6 months, and you're getting me mentoring you for the next 10 years, which is just crazy. Or you can do this. You can choose to be part of B1G1 year by year. In other words, just renew every year, in which case, depending on the size of your business, it'll be around $340 a year. So if you would like to do that, what we can do, yes, we've got to clear the room, but jump to the back of the room really quickly when we do this, and I'll give you some stuff that you can fill in. Is that okay? Really, really, really? Yeah, is that okay? Good, good, good. So, final little thing is this. Let's do this. There we go. There's that link. Now, if that's all too complicated for you, you can go to that link that we gave you right up front, and you'll find something else there. You'll find all of the slides that we just gave you. Is that okay? So, they will be there. You will also find a whole host of videos on different things. You'll find Simon's video there. You'll find lots of other videos that are there. You'll also see the opportunity to get involved in B1G1 as well. So go do that. And by the way, when you do this, when you truly understand that there's never been a time like this, that the world really needs us in business, it's never been more needed than now. So I would hope that as a result of you being here, and again, thank you for being there, for being here, for recognizing how important this day is. And I would hope that many of us would come and help us create more impact in our world than we ever imagined small to medium scale business can do. So let's get on purpose and let's transform this business, your business, and let's transform our world as a direct result. Show me your hands if you've enjoyed the morning so far. No, yeah, that's great. I hope that you get, thank you. That's extraordinary. Thank you. That wasn't to get applause. But what I want you to know is I've actually enjoyed it probably even more than you have. It's just been an absolute thrill. And as I said earlier, a privilege to be a part of this extraordinary, extraordinary day with some great, great people following. Thank you so much for being with me. Looking forward to connecting with you. Thank you, everybody. Awesome to see you. Thank you. Thank you. Here's Allison. Here she is. Thank you, Allison.
Round of applause for Paul Dunn. One of the things that I get to do being a member of the B1G1 is to do very much what he shared today. And so by your purchase of your ticket here today, we've helped over 100 entrepreneurs receive coaching, which is fantastic. So congratulations. All right, so we're going to head to a break, and what I'd like to position is that everyone collect up their personal belongings and take them with you. We have fresh beverages and some snacks in the lobby, and when you come back in, go ahead and grab a new seat with some new people. And so 15 minutes, because we have a number of very special things for you when you come back. All right. Thank you.